Well, hello everyone and happy Friday to you. This is Jason Sisco coming to you live from the Church Triumphant here at our main campus at 1030 Strawberry Road, Pasadena, Texas. We are so glad to have you with us for another one of our high noon broadcasts. What was born out of necessity is now sustained by our passion for God, our love for the things of the Spirit, and our desire to see His kingdom come in the earth. So thank you so much to all of our Church Triumphant family, for everyone that is connecting with us on a continual basis, for those that watch later, we welcome you. Thank you so much for your text messages, emails, all the different ways that you're communicating with the church. I say text message, I mean direct messaging through Facebook, but thank you so much for connecting with us and sharing your stories with us. A couple of broadcasts ago, I had a session where the Holy Spirit was working, and there were three different types of headaches that God showed me. And I just got a testimony via message the other day of someone that was watching at work, and I described the pain, and they stepped outside, and right there, God instantly took the headache away. Those are great stories and testimonies, and it's the result of you and I agreeing and praying together and seeing what God would do. So to all of our Church Triumphant family, we welcome you. And to all of our friends of Triumph, all across the United States and all around the world, what a joy it is to have you with us again for another broadcast. Let's open up our hearts. Let's open up our spirit. And let's just ask God to just help us to be just in sync with Him today and prepared for what's coming next. Father, we just thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you, God, for every way that you show yourself strong on our behalf. I thank you, Father, for the way that you give us your thoughts, the way that you help us manage our emotions. Father, I thank you for the way you give strength to our bodies. You give light to our eye and hearing to our ears. You give smelling to our nose and tasting to our tongue. You give the capacity to feel, to touch, and to be touched. I thank you, Father, for your Holy Spirit dwelling within us. I thank you, Father, that we can be the Kodesh Kodeshim, the literal holiest of holies. What an awesome privilege to be your people and to be the habitation of God as your church. I thank you, Lord, for your word today. We pray that the living word will just be alive in all of us and will illuminate your written word to us and give us direction in Jesus' name. We submit ourselves to you, spirit and soul and body, Father. Now lift your hands right where you are and thank him that he is renewing you, that he is revitalizing you, that he is refreshing and restoring you in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, for all of this in Jesus' name. You know, I think it's really interesting how many people are building relationships with each other on this broadcast, and I think that's really a beautiful thing as well. Thank you all for joining in from wherever you're joining from, as I said earlier. Yesterday, went a little long, but we were talking about preparing for fasting from a physical standpoint and also from a mental preparedness, is that if I can understand mentally what is going on in my body, if I have my mind wrapped around it right, it really helps me to be able to be focused. But our ultimate goal is that we would get into this relentless focus, relentless and resolute determination that we are going to break through and we're going to see the will of God accomplished over these next 40 days. Now, we have been in, if you just use the Jewish calendar, the month of Elul. And the entire month for the Jewish community, the observant Jews, is to be preparation for Rosh Hashanah, which is the head of the year. We talk about the head of the year. This is a feast in which they celebrate the creation of the world. They also celebrate the creation of Adam and Eve. And so they use this week leading up to it. If you're very, very practical, you say that Rosh Hashanah is the day that Adam and Eve were made, or the man and the woman were made. Therefore, creation would have been 6 days earlier. And so this week is all celebrating creation that God spoke and declared. And it was. He said, let there be, and there was. Bereshit bara et Elohim et hashamayim et haaretz. In the beginning created God the heavens and the earth. So I'm trying to quote there in Hebrew. But we celebrate this, that God spoke and it was done. And then we also think about the purpose of man. The Jews will teach that on Rosh Hashanah, leading up to Yom Kippur, which is 10 days later, this is a blowing of the shofar. This is the opening of our voice, the opening of our mouth to God, that we become the shofar in essence. The shofar is created from flesh. It's created from an animal, and it's obviously dead. The animal's been slaughtered. But then when you blow through the shofar, what is that doing? It is now putting breath through it. And the word breath is ruach. So when you have the Holy Spirit, it is the ruach hakodesh. It is the Holy Spirit. And through the Holy Spirit, we have breath or life. The same word for breath is the same word for spirit or life. And so when the breath breathes through the shofar, what is dead is now alive. And so we are mimicking creation and the breath of life coming into us. And we are acknowledging that God is our creator. The trumpet is also, when you blow the shofar, it is also the coronation. And so Yom Kippur is our day of judgment, but the books are opened on Rosh Hashanah in preparation for this 10-day period. They celebrate the new civil year. And so their special meal, and then from there they go into a season of contemplation and fasting of 10 days leading up to Yom Kippur. So they would think of Rosh Hashanah as the opening of the books, the beginning of the process of the testimony of our year, of how did we do, and we take personal assessment. This is when you bring your testimony before the judge, as it were, the case begins. But then on Yom Kippur, it is decided. The lamb is brought in before the holy place, the holiest of holies, and there God gives judgment about what will be and what will not be. And so we have atonement through the blood of the lamb on that Yom Kippur, the most holy of days. Now, of all the feast days that are given, this one is entirely spiritual. There is no other correlation. So for Passover, there is a physical correlation, them coming out of Egypt. And it's also the first fruits. And then you come into Pentecost. There is another harvest that is in Pentecost. So you have the bread that they bake in regards to a harvest day. And then you come into the Feast of Tabernacles, which is after Yom Kippur, Feast of Booths. There is harvest of fruits, etc., that coincide with that. But this 10-day period is entirely spiritual. It is only in regards to the kingdom of God. So it's the high holy days. So we are getting ready for this. We are preparing ourselves for this. The month of Elul for the Jews is that 30-day period of preparation. And then 4 days before, depending if you're Ashkenazi or whether you are Sephardic, you will begin this ultimate preparation leading up. So we are already in this deep preparation of ourselves for it. Now, obviously, as Christians, we are not observant Jews. We're not practicing Jews in that regard. But we can take the types and shadows that we learn from the Jewish, because they are our roots. We can take this and apply this and understand that these are highly prophetic and spiritual times. Many of the prophetic leaders around the world have special conferences and prayer meetings leading up to Rosh Hashanah because of the shift of what it means on that calendar. Every word, every letter, every image around Judaism and around Hebrew language gives us insights. And so as we talk about creation of the world, as we talk about man's birthday, we understand there's a reset There's a reset that goes on. And so as we come into 5781, what is this? It's the, we are transitioning to Rosh Hashanah, but it's happening on Sabbath. Now it's happening on Sabbath, so you do not blow the shofar on the Sabbath. That means that Rosh Hashanah, even though it's the Feast of Trumpets, will not have a blowing of the trumpets on this Saturday or on this Sabbath, starting actually Friday. Sundown is when it officially starts. The blowing of the trumpet will not happen. Typically, what they would do is have seven times of reciting Psalms 47 and then the blowing of the shofar. But they will not blow the shofar because the Rosh Hashanah begins on Sabbath. So that means this entire year is considered a Sabbath year. That what happens on Sabbath is what God is going to do for the entire year. So these are very significant times, very important times for us. And it means, in essence, is that God, because it's our Sabbath, God is the one that declares. God is the one that blows the shofar. So it's the heavenly shofar, the heavenly sound, rather than us blowing the trumpet here. It is a spiritual and prophetic blowing of the trumpet. So for us being in a Sabbath year of Rosh Hashanah, it denotes that this should be a great time of rejoicing, and this would be a time of the miraculous, that it's set aside. This entire year will be set aside for God to work. So these are the things that we glean from the Jewish calendar, and then we take them into the spiritual realm, and then we apply them practically to where we are right now. I'll have more to say about this 5781 as we progress, but we are preparing ourselves now prophetically and spiritually for this. So during this time, what they believe, what the Jews believe, is that the books are open for 10 days, and that's why they fast during this time. And they want to know who's going to be written in the book of life or who's going to be taken out of the book. In other words, God is going to take an account. He's coming to give an account of where we are and how we have progressed in our life with him. So this is why we take it, why the Jews take it so very seriously and why it's very important for us. You'll notice that in the New Testament, it says that if they confessed Christ at the Passover, they would be put out of the synagogue. What did that mean? The ramifications of that meant that each person had a seat in the synagogue and their name was written on the chair, literally written on the chair. We joke about this in Christian settings. What, is your name on that seat? You know, can't you let someone else sit there? But in the synagogues, they literally had a name inscribed where their families sat in the synagogue. And they were taught, even the days of Jesus, they were taught that if you were not seated on Yom Kippur in the synagogue, your name would be blotted out of the book of life. And so to be put out of the synagogue would mean that your chair would be taken out and you would not be counted worthy. You would be removed from the book of life because your chair would not be in the synagogue. You'd be put out of the synagogue. So this was, to the Jew, the most sacred and most holiest of days. And they were saying, we're going to remove your chair if you believe in Jesus. Wow. That is quite a, it would mean that you are no longer a part of the community. You are anathema. And so this is what they would threat them with. But how many understand today it is Christ himself that actually gives us the right to sit in his presence. It is through the blood of the Lamb that we actually have our names written into the book of life. It is the Lamb's book of life according to Revelation. And it's according to the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world is through Jesus Christ himself. He is not just our Passover Lamb. He is our atonement. Can we give him praise that he is our atonement today? We thank you, Father, that you are our atonement. You are our covering. You are our protection. You are our forgiveness. You are our hope. You are our Savior. You are our salvation. We thank you, Lord. He is Yeshua HaMashiach. He is Jesus the Messiah, and we give him praise today. Now, I gave you five points in our global prayer agenda. I will read them again. We are posting them for you. I also worked for 2 days with the Lord's help, to write a detailed agenda. And in the detailed agenda, my staff was looking at it. It's probably going to be 5 pages because it is 1 page per agenda item. I really wanted to give you time, even if you don't fast the entire 40 days, that you will carry the burden with us, that you will be in spirit, in agreement, in prayer for these 5 things that we are focusing on for the global agenda. Now, as we continue on, we're going to carry this into writing our vision for our local communities and writing the vision for our personal lives. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that as we progress. But let's review one more time. And I will just go through these just in a very quick way. This time, we're not going into much depth, but I'm just giving you a simple description for each one of these 5 agenda points. The number one is that the church and the world will see Jesus. We understand that this is the battle, that even more than territory, the battle is over the blindness of eyes, is that the God of this world has blinded the eyes, lest they come to the light of the glorious gospel in the face of Jesus. So when you come to the gospel, the knowledge of the truth, it is reflected in the face of Jesus. You see Jesus. Sir, we would see Jesus. And so the Bible gives us very descriptive terms on this, on the importance of seeing him, what that means to us personally, what that means to the church, ultimately what that means to the world. And so we are praying for our local community. We're praying for our friends, for our neighbors. If you want to get detailed and say specific names of people that you are praying for to come to the light of the glorious gospel, pray that. But even more, pray that God will help you to see Jesus. The Bible says in book of Hebrews chapter number 12, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. So what he is saying is you start by seeing Jesus, and that creates the author of your faith, but he's going to finish that faith. There is more impartation that is coming to you as you continue to see him. It is not look unto Jesus, it is looking. It is a continual process of looking unto him. And as we do, we get more revelation. Now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. But then the Bible also tells us it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, 1 John 3 verse 2, we shall be like him, for we'll see him as he is. So all transformation is directly related to our vision of Jesus. We all with open face, 2 Corinthians 3:18, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image. And so transformation is directly tied to seeing Jesus. But salvation itself is being battled over the blindness of men's eyes. And so we are praying and fasting that the world and the church will see Jesus. Number two, we are asking God to give us specific insight, as the sons of Issachar understood the times and knew what Israel ought to do. Now, there are 2 parts to this. There is a practical part and a prophetic part to the sons of Issachar. The sons of Issachar understood the calendars. In other words, they were able to write out the feast days to know what Israel ought to do because they understood the calendars. They knew the new moon, they knew the seasons of the equinoxes. They understood what was happening in the stars, in the heavens, because the Bible says the sun, the moon, and the stars were for times and for seasons and for days and years. Times means appointed times of God. So from the foundation of the world, God had appointed times that he was instituting, and he was using the heavens as our calendar so we would know our feast days. So the Jewish calendar is a lunar calendar. It is a lunar calendar. Rosh Hashanah is on new moon, slivered moons, concealed moon. And so it's telling us that there is something concealed around Rosh Hashanah, that it is a time of mystery, something hidden. And it's during this time of prayer that God begins to open our understanding to the hidden things. We expose what is hidden in our heart. He exposes what's hidden in his heart. So times and seasons and days and years. So the sons of Issachar helped Israel to know their new moon, helped them to know their feast days, their appointed times for Passover, for Pentecost, for trumpets, etc., for Rosh Hashanah, etc. So the Issachar sons were there for that purpose on a very practical level. There's also a spiritual correlation to sons of Issachar that says we can understand these last days, that the timing of God, the times and seasons. So what did the Bible say in 1 Thessalonians 5? And of the times and seasons, and of the times and the seasons, you are not ignorant. So in Acts 1, he says, you're ignorant of the times and seasons. But now that the Holy Ghost has poured out, he says, you know the times and the seasons. And so they are beginning to speak as the apostles and also as the prophets. They were able to give alignment to the church to understand the last days and what they meant. And so many prophetic words are coming in here. What we are praying for with number two is that the church will receive wisdom for the last days, so we'll know what to do. So we'll stay in step and alignment with God. These are very, very important things for us. Number three, we know that if there's going to be a change, if there's going to be a revival, if there's going to be a reconciliation, if there's going to be a healing of our nations, if there's going to be a healing of our states, if there's going to be a healing of our regions, if our communities are going to come back together, there has to be both repentance and forgiveness. There has to be reconciliation. So we are praying for the ministry of reconciliation to come on the scene, and that many, many people around the world will repent in identification repentance. We notice this with Daniel. We see this with Ezra and Nehemiah. We notice that they did not say, oh God, those people over there sinned, but I am righteous. They said, no, we have sinned. Our faces are confused. Our kings have failed. Our priests have been corrupt. Unto us belongs confusion of faces. Unto us belongs iniquity. Forgive us and forgive our forefathers. They did not say, oh God, forgive them. Oh God, wash away their sins. Help them all to get right with you. They identify. So we as Americans or whatever nation that you might be connecting with us, if it's Netherlands or Germany, or you're connecting with us from Spain or Brazil, or if you're UAE or we have many, many nations that are connecting with us, Philippines, if you're connecting with us, Central America, you're connecting with us in El Salvador. Okay, what are you doing? You are saying, forgive this nation, forgive us. We are representatives of this nation, and we ask you to forgive it. It's called identification repentance, where we take the sins of the nation upon ourselves, and we stand as a representation of the nation and pray. And so we speak that in the 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and heal. There will be a reconciliation in the land. The healing of the land is much more than just getting rid of the pestilence and the famine. The healing of the land is the healing of the relationship with God. It is the healing of the relationships with each other. It is reconciliation. So there must be a power of forgiveness. So part of this component of praying for a spirit of repentance is also praying for a spirit of reconciliation and healing, that we would overcome offenses and overcome division and divisiveness, hate speech, and that God will bring us back to true equality in our nation, in our generation. Number four, we come to divine visitation. And I use divine visitation rather than just simply saying we want miracles to happen, because a visitation is much more holistic. It's larger. It pulls in the harvest as well as God doing things that he has never done before. So this is what we are praying for. Can these bones live? When God asked Ezekiel that question, there had never been a mass graveyard that had been resurrected. There had never been bones that had been resurrected. But God said, can these bones live? Can I put flesh on them and skin on them and cover them again with hair and lips and eyes and ear? Can I restore the body completely and then put life in them? It's beyond anything he had ever seen before that God had done, but he was asking him to believe for it. God is doing the same thing with us. He is asking us to believe him for things that we've never seen done or never happened before. The glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the seas. The glory of the latter house will be greater than that of the former. God is wanting us to believe him for things that have never happened before. And so we're praying for divine visitations, that God will appear. He will manifest himself in glorious and awesome ways, that we will enter into the glory and that we will live there. Now, finally, number five is that we are praying for an extending of the space of grace. God gave this directive to me in 2010. It has been mirrored by many other prophets, many other apostolic leaders around the world since then, that God was going to give us a space of grace before persecution came in the Western civilization. There's already persecution happening in many other places around the world, but not in America, not in the degree that we know is possible. We feel a very anti-Christian element, a very hostile culture that's being fostered right now. It's a very powerful communistic agenda that is now being put out there. The pulling down of monuments, the destroying of American history. This has nothing to do with race relations. This has to do with something else. It's a political agenda to try to destroy our memory, our history, and also to reset everything in America to a total political climate. It is to disrupt and destroy our capitalist democracy, but it's also designed to destroy our Judeo-Christian roots and our biblical foundation. And so we know that if these far left groups get into office and they have power, that the more that they are there, we already see them in activist judges. We're already seeing this. People that are coming out even now, they were interrupting Jewish funeral services in New Jersey, but they're leaving the bars open. What is wrong with this? What is wrong with this? How is Planned Parenthood open? It's never shut. It's never closed down. What in Dallas, they were complaining it was closed for a month. Where am I going to go get my abortion? But the churches are closed. You can't sing. You can't sing in California in a church because that's how it spreads, is through singing. Okay, but you can protest in the streets. You can, I mean, whatever. It's so inconsistent is my point, because there's an agenda that is against the Bible. It's against Christianity. It's against our traditional values. And they are using this pandemic to push this agenda. And they're also using it to try to create a political change. And so we are not for personalities. We're not about people's character and lives. Politicians as a whole are not necessarily what you would say Sunday school teachers or pastors. We're not expecting them to be perfect at all. But we do have to look at their platforms. We see what do they believe in? What do they stand for? And if you read the platforms, that's where we have to do our due diligence. And we're praying for the will of God to be done. God showed me that if the church would pray, we could push back this hostility. We could bind the Antichrist spirit, and he would extend the spirit of grace and the space of grace upon the church. We know from 1 Timothy 2 verse 1, we're supposed to pray for, 2 verse 2, we're supposed to pray for kings and for all that are in authority. And here's the purpose, that we can live a quiet and peaceable life. So God, whoever you want in office, whoever you want to be in charge of our governments, in charge of our Congress, in charge of our courts, in charge of our legislation, and our execution of our laws, these executive branch, judicial branch, and legislative branch, whoever is going to cause the church to be able to fulfill his mission to reach the world and preach the gospel, that we can live a quiet and peaceable life. In other words, that we are unencumbered. Whoever is going to let the church continue to do its work, this is who we want in our office. And so these are things, and I'm trying very carefully to not sound too political today, but there is a lot at stake with what is going on right now. And many people are completely in the dark. They are just emotional. They're not substance related. They're just symbolism related. They're getting hyped up with a bunch of propaganda, and they do not know the real issues, and they do not know the roots behind things. And they don't study the platforms. They're not really rooted in reality of what's going on. They've just been told a bunch of things and believe it, and they don't do research. So we as the church have to stand, and we have to pray, we have to fast, and we have to ask God, is this a time for more reprieve? I would like to have another reprieve. We're coming into 2020. Everything is recalibrated. Everything has changed. We are dealing with a global society right now that is pushing a global agenda. We need our nation to remain strong, and we need to push back against this globalist society. God established the nations, but every time you see about globalism, there's always a demonic agenda that seems to be behind it, is that the Antichrist wants to make their one world government, wants to make their a one world economy, and a one world religion. And so when you see all these globalist elements that are in the world, many of them have Antichrist influence behind them, and they're pushing the Antichrist agenda. So we are praying and fasting primarily. And if you do not want to pray about the political aspects of things, then you can at least pray that God will help us to push back the Antichrist system. During this time of broadcast, God showed me one of the horses of the apocalypse. I saw him riding in, and the Lord showed me that the Antichrist system was trying to push the agenda before the time. We are seeing many things that are happening right now. They're testing us, folks. They are testing us to see how willing we are to accept the mark and to become a part of the global society. Folks, there are so many things that have already been done during this COVID-19 to tie us into the world banks with all of the debt that we owe. There is already so much freedom that we have lost. We do not even understand it. We do not even understand. And people are just buying into everything is free. It's not free. That $1,200 stimulus check cost the American taxpayer $28,000 per $1,200. If you can grasp how exorbitant that interest rate is for the American family, the American home, American citizen, it is exorbitant. And America is going deeper and deeper into debt, and we become a servant to our debtors. Who are those debtors? Do your research. You'll find out who's pulling the strings. So we are praying right now for a reprieve. We know that it's going more towards this global society that is going to seek to change times and change laws. That's what the Antichrist, according to Daniel 7, is going to do, change times and laws. And so we know that this is coming, but the church is here as a restraining force in the earth. So we're praying and fasting about it. With all of these things now in play, these five agenda items, I've given a lot more scriptures, etc., and the detailed agenda for you to do more biblical research. If you want to do other research outside of that, that's for God to lead you and direct you. That's not for me to tell you. But I do want to also bring in, when you take this into focus of where we are, what do we do now on a personal level? How do we apply this locally? And so what you do is that you begin to see, okay, what is happening in my community? What are some of the signs of these times in my community? What do I already know? So I'm getting my notebook out. What do I already know? So if I were to say for Pasadena, if I was going to write the vision, I would start by writing out prophetic words. So this is what I want you to do. If you are a missionary, you're a pastor, you're leading a group anywhere, you would start by writing out your prophetic words. You may have already done this, but take maybe the top most influential words and write them down. So I would give, for example, one of the prophetic words that we had is that God was going to make our church a habitation for armies of angels. So this was given to me about 3 years ago, that God was opening up a doorway in the spirit, that the heavens were open over the Houston area, and that our church was going to be a habitation. Pasadena would become a no-fly zone in the spirit, where the demonic powers would be completely wiped out in our area, and that God would cause us to be a place where the armies of angels would come and go. That was a very big and very powerful prophecy, okay? So I would write that one down. How to bring this to pass? I want to pray over this word. I want to confess this word. And then I would ask God for him to give me details of how I am going to see this prophetic word come to pass. What do I need to do to make this come to pass? So I'm fasting over the prophecy, and then I'm asking God for understanding. What does he mean by this? How do I apply this? And I would also say, well, then what's in the way? What are the principalities or what are the demonic spirits in my region? What do I know? So I would start doing research in my city and find out what are the biggest sins of my area? What are the biggest strongholds? And what do we need to do to take them out? So maybe on this part of town, I could put down, you know, drug addictions or things like this. But God has already given us more insight. So we saw in prayer, we saw a three-headed dragon that was in our city, a three-headed dragon. God told me the name of the dragon. The name of the dragon was depression. He told me that depression didn't just touch the poor, it touched the rich as well. And he said that there were many people in high places that were very depressed and even suicidal, and that many people in our community were abusing prescription drugs, not just drugs that you get on the street. And he said, and so I began to see how many antidepressants were being prescribed. We had people across our church, people in our leadership team, when I first came here, that were really struggling with depression. And I'm not faulting you if you have to go to a doctor and get some help. I'm not faulting that at all. What I'm saying is that God was showing me that depression was widespread. It was in the church. It was in the community. It was not just what you would say depressed because there was poverty. Okay, so I'm just giving you an example here from Pasadena, how God taught us. So then he showed us that there was a problem with finance. That was one of the heads. And then there was a problem with health, which was one of the heads. And then there was a problem with dysfunctional families that was a part of this. And so in each one of these groups, you'll see a cycle, that there was a cycle, these three heads going round and round. So if I have problems with my health, I can't have a good job. I keep not being able to work. If I can't work, then I have problems with my finance. And so if I have problems with my health and problems with my finance, I'm going to have a lot of problems in my home. I'm going to have stress in my home. So then I reach out and I look for help. So I get help and I become dependent. I become dependent on other people, whether it's government institutions, whether it's charitable institutions, or whether it's drugs or drug addiction. I suddenly cannot take care of myself. I am in a trap. I'm in a cycle. I'm in a bondage. And then it keeps repeating itself generation after generation. And so this is how depression becomes systemic and built in. So now what happens? What do you do to break that? So I'm talking about writing the vision. What are the prophetic words? Okay, what does God want us to do? He wants us to have a revival in these last days. But for my city, what am I praying for specifically? We started praying against these heads. And so we started teaching classes to help people get out of addictions. We taught financial peace to help people with their finances. We started talking about health. We started talking about divine healing and preaching about divine healing. We did whole classes on family every year, marriage classes, bringing all these things to start speaking to this. Because to break a prince, you become the opposite of it. But I asked God to give me a text, a biblical text that I could go from, that I would be a template to pray about. And so that's when God gave me Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. There are four levels there, going all the way to opening the house of the prisons. And the Lord said, these are the four stages of depression. What happens? To declare the acceptable year of the Lord, the day of judgment of our God, when God sets everything right, puts things back in order again, he cancels all the debt, he heals our bodies, he restores our homes. Okay, and then what happens? I'll give you beauty for ashes, and then I'm going to give you the garment of praise for what? The spirit of heaviness. Wow, there it is. Then he talks about us being trees. He's going to give us double for our trouble. If you continue to read down in this text, and it all comes through the power of the anointing of the Holy Ghost and the joy of the Lord, the oil of joy. And so now we begin to speak this into our church and you become the opposite. So you pray and fast to change out these mentalities and become the opposite. We are the church triumphant, victorious, celebrating, happy, alive, okay? Because here you can be free from drugs. Here your marriage is healed. Here God delivers you from your sickness and your disease. Okay, so this is what I'm talking about, of a way to write it corporately. So whoever you are, wherever, if you're not part of the Church Triumphant, you would take this for your church, your local church, even if you're intercessors, and you say, okay, we would like to apply this to our city. We like to apply this to our region. What's going on here? God, show us what we're up against, but don't just show me what's against me. I want to know, what are the prophetic words? What are the promises? What are the things that God has already told us that he wants to do? So if you don't have that information, you don't start with what's against you. Show me the three-headed dragon. No, you start with, what is for me? What am I doing? What has God sent me here? Why am I in this city? What is your goal in this city? What are you wanting to accomplish? What are the prophetic words? What are the gifts over this region? What does my city produce? And so from there, we then research, what are the generational curses that are over that city? We want to know what the blessings are so that we can replace the curse with the blessing. Does that help? Okay, I hope that can help you. So these are some of the examples. I want to write during this fast. I want to write as comprehensive of a list as I can write. So I'm going to be fasting and praying, and I'm going to be asking God for specific prophecies that I can lay down on a piece of paper, and then I can see the things that I already know, the text that I already know, and I'm writing that in. And then during this time, I'm praying this. I'm bringing this to God. I'm taking the word and I'm coming to Isaiah 61 and I'm going to pray it. We'll probably do that on one of our 40 days of prayer and fasting days. We will probably take a time and we'll pray that. It's universal enough. We can all pray it, but it will also be specific, because when we break things in Pasadena, it helps us to break things everywhere else we have influence. Does that make sense? So you want to get as specific as you can in your progression, and that helps you. And then you write out practical plans. So then I'll start asking questions around this. Okay, God, you've given me these five major things. How am I going to get these things done? What is the timing for these things? And then you start asking for people. Who do I need to be a part of this? What training needs to go into this? What do they need to know? And you're writing and you're going through your paper and you're writing and you're writing. Okay, this is what he said in Habakkuk. In Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 1, I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower. I will watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer when I am reproved. So I'm asking God to align me. I'm asking him to change me, to transform my life. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision. So I have a watch. I have a time, in other words, in which I have a watch. This is my time of prayer, my watch. I will set upon the tower. I'm also on this tower and I'm looking. I'm wanting to see during this time, okay? And I will watch to see what he will say to me. So this is the decade of pay. It is the decade of speaking. It's the mouth. I want to know what's coming from the mouth of God first. And then I want to know what I'm supposed to do about it, what I'm supposed to say. The Lord answered and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. He says, so it's going to look like it's tarrying for a little bit, but he says, but in truth, when you see the end result, you'll know that God was working the plan the entire time. So this is what we do. You spend the time to write the vision. So you write out, I wrote out a 5-point prayer agenda that I feel like all of us can agree and pray about together collectively. Now you get your own list and you write out for your local area the prophecies, promises, and then the things that must be dealt with in the spirit to be broken so that you can execute the plan. So you can execute the plan for your city and for your church. Now, the third component of writing the vision is the personal component. Personal component. So we will post, yes, we will post it on YouTube as well. I'll instruct my team to do that. So thank you for saying that. We will post it on YouTube in the comments, as well as putting this there for you on Facebook. If you want us to email it to you, I think we could probably arrange that, or put it on Messenger and send it to you on Messenger, if that will be helpful to you. I want you to spend some time, if you haven't already done this, if you're getting ready for your fast, if you're fasting starting on the first day of our fast that we've called, or if you're going to start fasting next week, wherever you're going to start, I want you to write out your list. And in this list, this is all about you taking an assessment of your life. God, what have you called me to do with my life? Am I meeting the goals that you've given for me? Am I doing the things that you called me to do? You're taking into account your life. You're stopping everything and you're eating because you want to, God, to change your course, to increase your effectiveness. And so you're praying over specific words, specific promises, and specific issues that you want solved. So if you have a business plan, okay, so God has told me that I'm supposed to write books. One of the things that I'm going to be fasting about is that God will help me with the execution of this dream and promise, okay? God also told me I'm supposed to learn Hebrew. So I'm back in seminary again, and I'm taking Hebrew again. I took a short break, but I'm back in it again. And I'm uploading again to my professors my work, and I work. But I'm asking God, help us, Lord, help me, Lord, to get this, to learn this, help me to understand. This is what you told me to do. I have 5 major lifetime goals, okay, and I'm working. I pray and fast over those lifetime goals. I have specific intermediate things, in other words, that are next steps that will be for staff, for our church, for series that I'm teaching, for the broadcast, for the future of this broadcast, what he wants me to do with it. Okay, so these are examples that I'm giving you, and I'm going to be praying for my family, praying over my kids, praying over my marriage. I'm praying over my finances. I'm praying over my health, okay? Praying over my schedule for next year, praying over all of these things. God, I want to bring the prophetic words that you're speaking for this season, and I want to lay hold upon them. And so this then ties into my overall prophecies for my life, which I have developed as a faith confession. And so in my faith confession, in addition to these specific agenda items that are related to my season of life and to the issues that I've been working on for a long time, and now I'm giving more attention to again during this time of fasting, laying more groundwork for them, okay, I also have my confession. I confess this is who I am. I confess this is what you called me to do. I confess the blessing of Asher over my life. Hundreds of thousands and millions of souls. We pray for 100 million soul revival in Houston. Okay, this is just my faith confession. I just speak it out. I just declare it. I confess it, and I get into that flow, and I let that carry me for a while of what God has promised, because he cannot lie. And so then you go back and you ask the things that you don't understand. This is where you ask questions. Why did this happen, God? Help me to understand. What am I supposed to do about this? Help me understand. Okay? So this is where we are. This is where we are. So I think that you have to look at your schedule, and you have to look at your life, and what you are doing by fasting is actually becoming constant in your prayer, praying without ceasing. So you're embodying it, okay? You're embodying it. Sometimes you will not be able to pray as long as others. Sometimes you are taking it in little bites, okay? So this morning, I just want to worship. This morning, I'm not doing anything, but I'm just worshiping. I'm opening up with worship. And so here's one of my gateways. Thanksgiving is a gateway. Intercession is another gateway. Prayer is another gateway. Supplication is another gateway. So these are different channels that I can get into in the spirit, and I can open that gate of praise and thanksgiving and worship. And this is just, sometimes this is all I'm doing. And I'm just thanking God in advance for his promises. I'm just thanking God for all the ways that he is working in my life. And I'm just being appreciative. There's other times when the burden is going to be so strong, you have to be willing to stop at any point in your day. Now, they say of Smith Wigglesworth, who had one of the greatest healing ministries in the last 100 years, Smith Wigglesworth said he never prayed more than 30 minutes, but he never went more than 30 minutes without praying. Okay? So he just said, he just kept checking in. So he would go do his work and then he would stop and he would pray. And sometimes he would pray 30 minutes at a time. Intense prayer. But in the meantime, what are you doing? This is something that I also learned from Brother Stone King, and I'll kind of wrap it up with this today. And I hope that I've just encouraged you today and helped you just with some very practical things. This may help you too. I think you have to learn how you pray best. And you're learning how to just stay in the stream of consciousness of God. Stay in the stream of consciousness. So I think, and I'm sharing a question here, sitting in silence or praying in tongues. I think this is, prayer is like a river. Prayer is like a river. There are points in the river where it goes very fast. There's sometimes where it's very deep. Sometimes it's narrow. Sometimes it's shallow. Sometimes it's very, very slow. What we are doing, prayer is relationship. Prayer is relationship with God. And so what I'm trying to do is stay in the consciousness of God. And ultimately, prayer is more about listening than it even is about speaking. Jesus says, as I hear, I judge. So I can do nothing but what I see my Father do and hear my Father say. All effective prayer begins in the heart of God. So what am I doing? I am seeking in my initial praying is to be able to know what are the prayers God is answering right now. What is God interested in right now? What does he care about right now? Here's my agenda. I'm bringing it. I know it's there. I know I have it. But what I'm going to start with is I may start with meditation. But if the stream is already flowing, I don't have to start with meditation. I'm already speaking it. I'm already declaring it. It's going to rush. There are some times when the burden is so strong, I don't have to pray to get through. I mean, I am there, I'm in it, and I just need to close that door and get on my face. Okay, I'm laying out, and the tears are flowing, and the sobbing, and the supplications. There's other times when it's not. It's moving very slow, and I'm a little distracted, and this is where I take the word, and now the word becomes my meditation point, and that's my launch point. Sometimes when I'm trying to understand what's going on, I'm battling something, I've got a big problem I'm dealing with, there's a heavy burden, I'm exhausted, I'm tired, I'm speaking in tongues now. I don't know what to pray for as we ought, okay? But I'm just praying in tongues and the Lord is leading me. But there are patterns, and this is what we have been doing all through this time, is there are patterns in the Word of God. And so I try to use these patterns to try to help understand. So if I can see the big picture of where we're going, this is why one of our components is to pray for the end times and to know what we ought to do. I want to see the patterns for the church. I've identified patterns for the church. I have at least 13 end time church patterns that I have found. Okay, I probably have more. I'm going to keep studying this. So our studying, we bring the studying here to come back into prayer again. So it becomes a cycle. The more that I study, the more it opens up my mind, the more faith that I have, the more flow that I have. And then the more the unction comes to pray prayers I didn't pray before, or to pray clearly prayers that I've been praying before, but didn't really understand the why behind them. So I hope that helps you. But our ultimate goal is for us individually to have mastery, for our church to have dominion, and for the global church to prevail around the world so that God's will can be done in the earth, so his kingdom can come, and so that we can collectively see the harvest of souls and the discipling of nations to be made in Jesus' name. So this is our desire. I'm going to pray for you right now. I'm going to ask God to give you some understanding, some revelation. I'm going to ask God to sustain you, to give you strength. We're going to pray together. Let's all agree together that God will help us. I need the spirit of fasting to come upon me as well. I am praying that God will give me the insight. When I said I'm praying for you, I'm saying we're going to pray together, collectively pray together. But right now, extend your hands, if you will, and let's pray. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. And we're asking you, God, to give us a clear strategy, a clear plan. Help us to know your will. Help us to pray the things that are the most important to you. Give us your priorities. And then give us, oh God, the disciplines that we need, the mastery of ourselves. Give us the mastery of our energy. Give us the mastery of our thinking, of our processing. Help us, oh God, not to get sucked into traps, not to be sidetracked, not to spend too much time on negative things. But I pray that you would direct our study, direct our prayer, direct us, oh God, as we enter into this new prophetic year, this new time for the kingdom of God. Even though we have a Gregorian calendar, for us it's still 2020, but this evening begins a new civil year for your people, and this is the calendar that you follow. There is something that is shifting and changing. God, we thank you for 5781 beginning this evening. We confess, oh God, even now, God, as the time zones are ahead of us here on Central Time, as we're getting very close to this, God, I pray that you would impart to us both the celebration, oh God, the insight, the prophetic understanding, and also the discipline and the strength, oh God, to fast and to pray and to endure. We thank you, God, for the ushering in of the year of miracles, the ushering in of you taking us, oh God, into your arms, taking us into the glory. And so I pray, God, that you would direct our individual plans and strategies, that you would help us to write the vision, to make it plain, and that we would be effective in Jesus' name. Enjoy your celebrations tonight, and we will connect with you next week. We will already be engaged in the fast by next Tuesday. So the flesh should already have been, the flesh should have already been into a state of being crucified in Jesus' name. So we should already be processing on a different level and hearing God very clearly. So I'm looking forward to sharing, looking forward to praying with you, and we're going to war, folks. We're going to war. So get your armor on. Don't stand in the shadows when you can live in the light. This has been our High Noon broadcast. God bless you. We love you.